I, Emmanuel, donde tenemos pasión por Dios y compasión por todos, which means, welcome to Emmanuel, where we have a passion for God and compassion for all. We want to say welcome to everyone who is here this evening. We ask that if you feel comfortable enough to please go ahead and silence your cell phones. We just have a few brief announcements we'd like to share. This Sunday, we'd like to remind everyone to feel free to go ahead and wear some kind of hat or head covering. For each person who wears a hat or head covering, a dollar will be given to the Lunchbox Ministry. We'd also like to remind everyone that after worship on Sunday, we have an absolutely delicious brunch of biscuits and gravy and eggs. And we also have a sign-up sheet in the narthex for anyone who is able to volunteer an hour or two next weekend for the Soda Fest. Now, for the past 52 weeks, we have started every service by saying all the stress and all the worries from the week before, now is the time to set aside. The truth is, tonight is different. Tonight is about bringing your stress and your worries and your feelings of mortality to this sacred space and to this sacred time, and to experience what the Holy Week means and what it represents. With that being said, we invite you all to join our musicians as we enter into the sacred space and the sacred time by singing our mission theme song. Tonight, we recall a final meal that is shared by friends.
We remember what it was like when we all sat at the table.
Tonight, we recall the solitude of Jesus, his late night vigil in the garden, praying.
We recall his suffering and shame and the deep loneliness he felt.
Please join us now in singing a musical blessing, Near the Cross, verses 1, 2, and 4.
Thank you.
preparation, let us fix our eyes on Jesus.
Safely turn to our neighbors and extend to one another a sign of welcome and a sign of grace. And knowing that we have people worshiping with us from all over, let us turn to the camera in the back and also extend to them a sign of welcome and grace. And you may face forward. Even as the darkness falls and the lights dim, the Lord is with us every step of the way, and with every mistake that we make. Let us bring our silent confession into this sacred time, knowing that God listens to our voices. Let us now enter into our own time of silent reflection. And I ask that you extend your hands to us as we extend our hands to you, as we say, Jesus heals our hearts, forgives our sins, and walks beside us. We are surrounded by grace and not forgotten.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Let's sing the Kyrie, everybody, please.
This evening, thinking about how I've been here for 14 years, and there's a lot of familiar faces who are not here this evening. Part of that is the reality that as we age, driving at night is not something we do. Knowing that we have people who have moved away and are either excitingly starting a new chapter, or they realize that they're coming to the end and the final chapter. Thinking about people like Charlie, who had to bury his beloved bride unexpectedly, and our sister Sandra, who received the news that her living conditions have forever been changed. Thinking about the children in Somalia and how hungry they are, and we just don't hear about them in the news. And then thinking about a recent clergy group I was part of, in which one person was so adamant that we pray for Palestine. Meanwhile, there was a dark-skinned woman who was one of our peers who kept typing in, pray for Haiti, pray for Haiti, pray for Haiti, and her comments were completely ignored. And I may be crossing a boundary at this moment, but when I asked Carnide, how are things going in Haiti, she said one of the most poetic things I've ever heard. She said that if people eat, it's either by mistake or miracle. Carnide, I don't know if I've ever heard something so exquisitely, but yet painfully expressed. And thinking about tonight, we are gathering to remember a final meal. And that we have our Haitian sisters and brothers, people that Carnide knows, in places that Carnide has walked, where families are being torn apart and struggling, and the concept of, do I eat tonight, all comes down to either a mistake or a miracle taking place. So with that being said, and with the knowledge of what's taken place in Baltimore, and the recent automotive deaths that have taken place in Highlands, let us now enter into our own time of silent prayer. And then after a few moments, I will go ahead and conclude that prayer. Let us enter into a moment of sacred and prayerful silence. Holy One, we are entering into a time of sacred chaos, a time in which we are aware of suffering and mortality and the cruelty of the world. And we are mindful of the events taking place in Haiti, the suffering and hunger in Somalia, as well as the Ukraine and Palestine and Israel, and those in Russia who dealt with the violence at a concert. Lord, we're also aware of the pain and suffering that takes place within our own personal lives and our neighborhoods and our community. And we ask, Holy One, that during this time, your spirit move through our brokenness and you find a way to move through those waters of chaos, to bring forth new life, to remind us that we are never alone, and to continue to find ways to make the resurrected Christ present, if even all we are experiencing are crosses. It is in your Son's name we pray, and we say, Amen. Amen.
Drive the nails through my hands, laugh at me.
Please stand as we join to say these sacred words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Let's all sing our communion hymn.
Let us break bread together.
Here at Emmanuel United Church of Christ, we have what is called an open table policy, which means no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome to participate in this sacred and holy meal. At this table, we embody the fellowship of Jesus.
We experience the grace of God, the love of Christ, and the presence of the Holy Spirit.
Remember who Jesus ate with. Friends who were floored, leaders who doubted, folks who believed, and those with questions.
We look upon this table, thinking about the life of Jesus, knowing that he was willing to die with the kingdom of God.
On his last night, Jesus ate with his followers. When God raised Christ up, he ate with them once again by the seaside.
We are united before this table, aware of Christ's love for humanity.
We celebrate God's raising of Jesus, justifying his words and his ministry.
We rejoice in the gifts of the Holy Spirit, who continues to inspire us.
Beloved by our Creator, we are one. Fed at Christ's table, nourished in body, mind, and spirit.
We shine bright with the gospel. Amen.
Amen. So, one of our unofficial traditions has been inviting someone to come forward to participate in the sacrament of communion. Mary, I would love if you would be that person for this evening. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul was writing to one of the very first churches when he said, "For I have received from the Lord what I now pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was to be betrayed, he took a loaf of bread. And after giving thanks, he took that bread and he broke it. And he said, 'This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And then, in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and after pouring it out, he said to them, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this every time you gather in remembrance of me. For every time we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we are proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes." I'd like to now ask everyone to please extend your hand so that we can consecrate the elements together. Gracious and Holy One, as we share in this fruit of the vine and this grain of the field, we ask that you not only bless these elements, but that you bless us, and that you bring us closer to you, the source of all blessings. It is in your Son's name we pray and we say.
Amen.
I'd like to ask our communion stewards to please come forward. You know, we talk about how if anything can go wrong on Maundy Thursday, it does. Because that's what keeps us centered and focused. Becomes a wonderful teachable moment. And the question is, why do we do the bread first? And does it really matter?
Yes.
And does God fully understand, and is God possibly even smiling right now, that even on such a serious night, there's still that element of humor and laughter that can take place? So friends and family, it is through the broken bread that we participate in the body of Christ. Take and eat, for this is the body of Christ, which has been broken just for you. Thank you. Through the cup of the new covenant that we experience the gifts of eternal life. Take and drink, for this is the blood of Christ which has been shed just for you. Now that we have been fed at the Lord's table, let us join together and say, gracious God, thank you for what we have received. Your presence inspires us to live a life of justice, kindness, and humility.
when it was evening, he took his place with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, "Truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me." And they became greatly distressed and began to say to him, one after another, "Surely not I, Lord." He answered, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to the one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born." Judas, who betrayed him, said, "Surely not I, Rabbi." He replied, "You have said so."
Then Jesus said to them, "You will all become deserters because of me this night, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go ahead of you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Though all become deserters because of you, I will never desert you." Jesus said to him, "Truly, I'll tell you this very night, before the cocks crow, and you will deny me 3 times.
He came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not come into the time of trial." Then he withdrew from them, about a stone's throw, knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done." Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. In his anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down on the ground. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial."
After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had in your presence before the world existed. I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through them, that they may all be one. As you, Father, are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one.
After Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples and crossed the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees. And they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them.
Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters. And they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. And they began saluting him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him.
My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest. And yet, you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel, in you our ancestors trusted. They trusted, and you delivered them. To you they cried and they were saved, in you they trusted and they were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not human, scorned by others and despised by the people. All who see me mock at me, they make mouths of me, they shake their heads. They say, commit your cause to the Lord, let him deliver. Let him rescue the one in whom he delights. And yet it was you who took me from my mother's womb. It was you who kept me safe on my mother's breast. On you I was cast from my birth, and since my mother bore me, you have always been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help.
Tremble, tremble.
The light of Christ has been extinguished. The altar has been stripped. We now go out into the world, aware of the darkness that has fallen upon us, wondering, where is God? Does God still exist? Does God still care? How are we going to make it through this weekend? And one of the answers is we make it through the weekend by being kind to our neighbors, by showing justice, by showing kindness, and continuing to be as humble as we can. May you go in peace, and may you go in love. Amen.
Oh,